some things that we kind of take for granted. And I've learned a lot in doing this alongside of Thea and Dean and Adam, and you guys have been so tremendously helpful in this whole week of things that have happened. We've had a clothing swap, we did workshops, students, you know, as much time as they could give, they gave. So all of you, thank you so much. I am now part of the Board of Fashion Revolution, so I'm going to continue on making education a primary aspect within Fashion Revolution USA. I'm very excited. And I think we're going to expand this not only to colleges, but to high school too. And we've already done a toolkit to help promote this in high school students, because it's that purchasing power. Once you have that, you got to know where your clothes are coming from. And people don't realize, and I know you guys in studio all the time, people don't realize that there's not a machine that's making these clothes. So we're bringing that awareness. Thea is here also because she represents a more national view of also apparel designers network.
Sure. So we're here with the Apparel Designers Network. Hi, everybody online who's joining us from there, and thanks to Rizzi for letting us be here and be part of the Fashion Revolution. Kathy makes a huge effort getting it together, and the students really do too during their busiest time of the year. So we really appreciate all that the students are doing to help us. We really couldn't get it done without the student contributions, and thanks to Dean, and thanks to everybody who's been helping so much. We have some speakers here today that we're really excited about. We have Joey, I can't remember your last name, I'm sorry.
Joey DeFrancesco.
Joey DeFrancesco is going to be speaking to Fashion's Past a little closer to home, because we feel really strongly that if people kind of make a connection that something like what happened in Rhode, some of these things happen really right in our own backyard, and it was somehow it got forgotten, and we allowed it to happen on a much grander scale overseas, and just because we're exporting it doesn't make it okay. We also have Janelle Toogood. We're really lucky to have Janelle here. She's from Samsonite right here in Massachusetts, and Janelle is going to be speaking to Fashion's Present, some really amazing initiatives that are going on at her company and elsewhere to try to make fashion a little more sustainable, to try to make things a little bit better for our planet. And then I have the task of talking to the future, which in a way is the easiest because it's anybody's guess. But there's some really exciting things that are currently happening that are a little glimpse of some of the miraculous things that come that might make a change. So I think that's everything we have to say to introduce everyone. With no further ado, we'll have Joe come and give us his presentation. Thank you.
So again, my name is Joey DeFrancesco. I used to work regularly at the Slater Mill Museum in Pawtucket, which is this place that you see here. I now am there occasionally. I do special programming there. I give presentations to other museums in the area, specifically around kind of labor history issues. And talking about the past of the textile industry here in Rhode Island is really special, of course, because this place is the first textile factory in the United States, right? This is the beginning of the U.S. apparel industry, is the beginning of the Industrial Revolution in the United States. It's built in 1793. It's a museum in Pawtucket. We're now just 10 minutes from here. If you go there today or after, it was worth going to see, but you'll see a very different tour than what I'm about to tell you all about, because usually the tour, like a lot of textile museums, the textile industry, it's going to be focused on talking about like the names of the great men who built these places, so like Sam Slater, who's at Slater Mill, Moses Brown, like Brown University, who financed the place. And also talking about the technology, right? Like the progress of technology and how great this is, and we make more stuff faster and all this stuff. What gets left out usually, of course, is the whole story of who worked in these places, both in this factory and then all the way down the production line to, of course, the slaves down south who were picking the cotton that then became the thread and the clothing via these mills here. So that's the story we're going to focus in on here. And again, it's a really important place because this is where the Industrial Revolution, the U.S. Industrial Revolution, it sort of began in the UK before here, but it began here in Rhode Island. You might look around Rhode Island and think this is kind of small, significant place, but all of these old brick mill buildings you see around you have a really important story. So I'm going to be moving through a lot of history really quick We usually have a little bit more time, but usually I like to go back in time to the beginnings of Rhode Island to kind of talk more about just the story of where the money came from, right? The capital accumulation that even led to industrialization in the beginning, because it's a really important piece of the story. So we're just going to kind of fly through this really quickly to immediate pre-colonization, right? This is a map of Rhode Island. This is a very generalized map. There's, of course, people living here before Roger Williams came here. This is a very general map that you can see the Narragansett people in northern, eastern Rhode Island. On the border of Connecticut, there's also the Pequot people in the antic southern Rhode Island. More northern and eastern Rhode Island, the Wampanoag people, these people were here, of course, for hundreds of thousands of years before Roger Williams shows up. Roger Williams was kicked out of the Massachusetts Bay Colony in 1636, comes down here, has relatively good relations with the indigenous people for a very small amount of time before the colony started expanding, war breaks out. Of course, the Pequot War in the 1630s that results in a mass enslavement of the Pequot people, mass killing the Pequot people. Roger Williams himself took a Pequot child as a slave, which is also not something you're going to see like the Roger Williams Park over there. The next big conflict, the colonies keep expanding, sucking up more and more land, infringing on indigenous sovereignty. This erupts in the King Philip's War in the 1670s. King Philip was the English name of a Wampanoag leader named Metacom, or Metacomet. This is him here. He sort of united the indigenous groups in this area in southern New England against English colonization. That war ends with some also very large-scale massacres, including one in southern Rhode Island in the Great Swamp, mass killing of Narragansett people, mass enslavement of a lot of Narragansett people, many of whom remain in Rhode Island as enslaved people, some here in Pawtucket and in Providence in the cities, many being forced to work on plantations in South County, Rhode Island. So we don't think of Rhode Island as a kind of plantation economy like that, but in fact it was in southern Rhode Island. So this is a painting called The Economic Activities of the Narragansett Planters. It's painted by a person named Ernest Hamlin Baker. This is actually painted in the 1930s. This is not, contemporary to the history we're talking about, but it's depicting what was going on in South County, Rhode Island in this time period. So you can sort of see enslaved people, they're training horses, were a big export, and then a lot of what they're moving here is rum barrels, okay, moving around rum in Rhode Island. It's a very important economic activity, and first this slave work was of course being done by indigenous people, so the first people enslaved here before sort of large enslaved African population in Rhode Island. Rhode Island had a very large enslaved population, especially compared to around New England. By the dawn of the American Revolution, some 1 in 14 Rhode Islanders was enslaved. And this is really what characterizes the 18th century Rhode Island economy. So again, Slater Mill, the first factory industrialization, kind of like 1790, that begins. So when we say 18th century, we're talking pre-industrialization. It was all about the slave economy. So it was this stuff happening in South County, but then more importantly, it was the slave trade that built Rhode Island and then built the factories in Rhode Island. So what do I mean by this? Well, this is the famous triangle trade you might have heard about. So what was happening is slave ships were being outfitted here in Rhode Island, this is Newport, and then taking rum to the coast of Africa where they're trading the rum for slaves and bringing the slaves back to the Caribbean, where they were trading the slaves for molasses, which was then brought back up to Rhode Island and made into rum, which was then put on those boats, and so on and so on. This was the main economic activity in Rhode Island pre-industrialization. Rhode Island's ports, so Newport, Bristol, Providence, were the main slave ports in North America. So for a lot of the 18th century, some 60% to 90% in certain years of slave voyages destined for the coast of Africa were coming from Rhode Island. Okay, this is not a southern thing, slavery. It's coming from Rhode Island. And it encompasses the entire state economy. So it's not only making these personal fortunes, right, for people like John Brown here, okay, it's also making money for any artisan involved in this enterprise. So shipbuilders, people distilling the rum, weavers who are outfitting clothes to be sold on those plantations. Okay, the entire Rhode Island economy is based on this. This painting, I think, kind of sums this up. This was, in fact, painted in the 1750s. 1950s, and this is a painting called Slave Captains Carousing in Suriname. Suriname being the country at the northern tip of South America, is an important destination for many of these enslaved people. So this is painted by a person named John Green. So of course these sea captains are all slave trade captains, right? So in this painting, we have Nicholas Cook, Cook with an E, like the street, who was the first governor of Rhode Island, the governor of the colony of Rhode Island. We have Stephen Hopkins, who is also a governor of the colony of Rhode Island, Chief Justice of the Rhode Island Supreme Court, and signed the Declaration of Independence. This, in here, we have Joseph Wanton, who is a merchant and a governor of the colony of Rhode Island. This is Isaac Hopkins. He has his own museum here in Providence. Isaac Hopkins has. He tapped into the Sally, the slave ship that the Brown family commissioned, and he was the first naval commander of the U.S. Navy, all in this one painting from the 1750s. So this kind of summarizes really the Rhode Island economy in this time period. Okay? At the same time, there's this really wealthy class of people being created. We have the creation of that artisan class I was talking about. We also have the creation of this growing underclass of white people here in Rhode Island. So these are people who don't have any land, okay? Because these guys are increasingly sucking up the good land, and this is Rhode Island. There's not a lot of land to begin with, so this dream of being this kind of yeoman farmer character is increasingly drying up for a lot of people. There's also a general economic depression following the Revolutionary War. So the number of opportunities for a lot of people are drying up. So again, right at the dawn of industrialization, maybe 10% of people in New England, of the white population of New England, were considered vagrants, okay, or unwanted persons. So people could be taken by the state or who moved from town to town. These are the people who are the first factory workers are going to be drawn from. These people who have really no other options to begin with. And they're going to be drawn back into Slater Mill here. So now to turn to the story of this mill. So this place was built, and again, it's the first factory, by Samuel Slater. So Sam Slater was born in England in a town called Belper. And again, the British Industrial Revolution began before the U.S. Industrial Revolution. So they had textile mills in Britain as early as the 1760s. So Sam Slater is born into this rapidly industrializing economic situation. He's from a pretty wealthy family. If you go to the museum now, some of the tour guides like to paint him as this kind of rags to riches thing, but it's not really true. He's from a pretty wealthy family. He's born in this wealthy estate called Holly House. And he happens to live next door to a guy named Jedediah Strutt, who was one of the first big industrialists in the UK and the first textile industrial revolution that was happening over there. And Sam Slater gets a job apprenticing under Jedediah Strutt as a young man. So he starts to learn the ins and outs of building textile machinery, which we'll take a look at in a minute. So he's learning how to build the textile machinery, how to operate the water power that powered the textile machinery, and he's learning how to create a labor force that will work in here, because what they're going to demand of workers in here is entirely different from any previous occupation. The idea of sitting at a machine, a textile machine, for 14 hours a day, 15, 16 hours a day, totally different than what these pre-industrial weavers, blacksmiths, whoever, were doing here. Okay? So they built this place, Sam Slater comes here in 1789. From Belper, England. He had heard word that these factories did not yet exist in the US. Okay, many cities around here were offering high rewards for English mechanics who would come and help them create this sort of textile mill. So Slater gets on a ship, he sneaks out, supposedly tells his mother he's going to London for the weekend, and then sneaks on a boat, comes to America, he never goes back to England, because it was illegal for these kind of skilled mechanics to leave the UK at the time. They especially didn't want these skilled mechanics with all the secret industrial knowledge coming to the U.S. who they fought a war with. So Sam Slater has to kind of disguise himself, sneaks on the boat, comes to the U.S., eventually gets in touch with Moses Brown. Again, Moses Brown, School of Brown University, all this money made from the slave trade. Moses Brown had been trying to create textile machinery for a while, but had failed to do so. So Sam Slater kind of became the last piece of this. And together, first they built a small workshop, which was up the river a little bit, but then in 1793, they succeed and built slave mill. Again, the first textile mill in the U.S. So now we're going to go into the mill a little bit to take a look at what was actually happening here, which we'll get to the actual stories of these workers. So what you see here is a cotton gin. So it's a textile mill. These first mills, they were not even producing finished cloth. What they were doing was taking raw cotton, putting it through a series of steps, and it was coming out as cotton thread. So for the first 30 years, they were just making thread, and then it would still be sent out to household weavers, this kind of contracting system. So for a while, until they got the power looms, which was until about the 1820s, we're just making thread. So we're gonna kind of go through that process. Now, it of course starts with the raw material and the cotton gin. All of this is happening on plantations down south. So at first, we're not talking deep, deep south yet. Slavery spread south and west as time goes on. But first, we're talking about the northern parts of Georgia, the Carolinas. Now, before the cotton gin was invented, slaves would pick the cotton, which is already, of course, backbreaking work, but then they'd also have to do this difficult task of removing seeds from the cotton, which is a pretty arduous thing to have to do, and it really created a bottleneck in terms of production, right? If you can't get the raw material of cotton, these factories could not function. You couldn't have a modernized textile industry. Conveniently, the same year this factory is built, Slave Mill, this machine is invented by Eli Whitney's cotton gin, 1793. Okay? So what this does is you feed cotton into it. I know this picture's getting all blurry, so you can't really see what's going to happen, but you're essentially feeding cotton into it. These barrels have cones on them, which rip apart the cotton, remove the seeds automatically, and it comes out the other end ginned or de-seeded. So it dramatically accelerates the speed at which you can process large amounts of cotton. Now, Eli Whitney supposedly was something of an abolitionist, and he thought, hey, this machine is going to, another larger cotton gin, help end slavery, because slaves don't have to do that stuff where they take the seeds out of them, right? Of course, the very opposite of this happens, because this machine enables the technological process by which you can have industrialization, enables cleaning up massive amounts of cotton all at the same time. So the same time that this happens, these factories up north start popping up, and England as well. So all of a sudden, there's this huge demand for cotton. Okay, so the combination of this machine and the demand created by these factories up north means that slavery explodes in the United States. Okay, so by 1790, slavery in the U.S. was actually pretty stagnant. The plantations, which were largely growing tobacco and indigo in Virginia and the Carolinas and the Chesapeake Bay area, were actually starting to go into decline, and many slave owners were actually considering getting rid of slaves. However, all of a sudden the Industrial Revolution starts to happen, and these factories in Pawtucket and Providence start buying up all this cotton. They make slavery very valuable again. So you can see what happens as the Industrial Revolution goes on. You see an explosion in the number of slaves from around 700,000 to maybe 4.5 million enslaved people in the U.S. by the dawn of Civil War. This is because of these factories, right? This is one big cotton economy, one big textile economy. Slavery, cotton, plantation, that was not just a southern problem, okay? This was the U.S.'s economy. This is the foundation of capitalism, modern capitalism. This is just another, this is really the story of the expansion of the U.S., right? We expand west for more slave land to feed these factories up north to create more money. Cotton is what fuels the westward expansion of the United States, again, seeing pre-industrial and then sort of throughout the industrial age. You can see this even more directly in Rhode Island. I think I moved to that slide a little bit too quickly. I'm a child now. In more directly in Rhode Island, which is why it makes it an interesting case, because you can follow it from these families. So the Moses Brown, the Brown family, they made some money in the slave trade, and then they invested that money in factories, which then prolonged slavery. There's also a family called the DeWolf family. So James DeWolf was one of the most infamous slave traders in history anywhere, but he was based in Bristol, Rhode Island, and almost single-handedly made Bristol, Rhode Island one of the slave trade capitals of the world. DeWolf then took a lot of that money and built a city called Arkwright, Rhode Island, which was a village on the border in Cranston, and started producing cotton there. So you kind of see the totality of this economic cycle here. Rhode Island went even deeper, though, and started to focus on something called Negro cloth, which was cheaply made cloth, which was designed to clothe slaves in the southern plantation. So think about that economic cycle. You have someone like James DeWolfe made all of this capital in the slave trade, invested it into a textile mill, which was using slave-picked cotton to then make cheap clothing, which was then sold back to the plantations to clothe the people that he probably participated in trading in the first place, okay? That's the cotton economy. That's the connections here. That's the beginning of the textile industry, and really the U.S. economy. Entering the factory now, we didn't have slaves. Slavery was legal in Rhode Island until well into the 19th century, but they had the next few disturbs of labor, which was in this case young white children. At first, Slater used people called pauper apprentices, who were people from very poor families or orphans who were taken by the state and put in the service. So before the Industrial Revolution, it would be like a farmer. You go and learn how to be a farmer. Now, you just go and, you know, work in a factory. So Slater's first batch, the first batch of textile workers, maybe 20 kids who were pauper apprentices, who were working also for free. They're supposedly, you know, getting room and board and eventually gain some kind of economic freedom. But Slater quickly actually finds out this is too expensive to have pauper apprentices, too expensive to clothe and feed and house these kids. So he moves to an even cheaper source of labor, which is free labor of children from the surrounding families. So he moves to using kids from these families, from these very economically depressed people, really the poorest of the poor. We start to get maybe 30, 40 kids working in this mill. They're making maybe 40 to 60 cents a week, working 12 hours in the winter months when it was darker, right, this is pre-electricity, and then 14 to 16 hours in the summer months when there was enough light to be able to see this machinery. We talk about all these topics for a really long time, so I'm kind of forcing myself to keep moving here. This is an example of something the kids might be working on. This is called a carding machine, just to move around in our process. I think there might be one of these in the bathroom, actually, here. I don't know if anyone knows exactly what that is, but it looks like it's a hand-powered carding machine. How this works is you take that ginned cotton from the bale, feed it into this. There's also sets of teeth on this barrel, a water-powered belt would make the barrel spin, the cotton would get ripped apart, it kind of lines up the fibers and gets it ready for the next spinning process. Used to be able to have to do this by hand, with actual things that look like cards that you rip the cotton apart. This is the industrial version. So you can imagine, this is pretty dangerous work for these kids. You have these two spinning barrels with metal teeth on them, ripping stuff apart all day for 14 hours a day. So injuries, of course, are very common. I have examples from right here in Rhode Island where mill supervisors are saying things like, oh, so-and-so got hurt on the carding machine today. It's this great calamity because now the carding machine has stopped working and there's blood on the cotton. We have to get rid of this batch of cotton, right? So you can see from just even the descriptions of these injuries how much stock they took in their workforce. This is another picture. Obviously, these photos are not from the 1790s, but they're still representative of what it kind of looked like in these mills. And it would come to be very slowly a more combined workforce where you would have kids and then adults, first young women and then some adult men, also working in these factories. So they keep going through the machinery. This is called a drawing frame. This takes the carded cotton and kind of makes it into these nice strips, which are going to get ready to be loaded onto the actual spinning machines. So as the centuries wear on, from 1793, the first mill, you see an explosion of mills here in Rhode Island. So they spread all over the state, to here in Providence, all the way up to Woonsocket. You see these little mill villages start to be created, like Slatersville, Rhode Island, which is within Smithfield, is founded in 1806 by Sam Slater's brother, John Slater. So this is the first mill village of that design, where there's like a mill and a bunch of little houses, and there's a church, and there's a mill store, and it's just all kind of put in the middle of nowhere into some rural area. This is a pattern that's followed all over the U.S., and a lot of these towns are still there. And if you, you know, drive up 146 here and around, you see all of it. You see a lot of the mills, you see a lot of that mill housing still, or restored versions of it remaining here. So that continues. continues on, and as the mills expand again, we get more and more different types of people working in here. So we get these young women start with the next kind of cheapest source of labor. You get some adult men, and correspondingly, you start to get more and more resistance on the parts of everyone working here. So even with the kids, they found it very hard to keep the kids in the mill. These kids would run away in really large numbers. Their kids, their parents would take them out of the mill. Certain workers would have these ongoing fights with Slater over things like having the kids work by an oil lamp. So the first night Slater lights oil lamps, three of the parents take all of their kids out of the factories because it was unheard of to work at nighttime, right? Pretty much sure you don't work at nighttime. So the idea of working by lamps once in the night for the same 12 hours a day is a big deal. And you start to see it with adults too, right? So there's various forms of resistance. Running away is still a big one. Arson becomes a fairly common mode of resistance, right? Many mills are set on fire during this time period. There's cheap wood mills, so often they can light up very easily. Theft, of course, is also really common. This is going to continue to build until we get to the first big strike, which we'll talk about in a second. The concept of time becomes a big sticking point. So with factories, of course, one of the most famous architectural points is the bell tower, right? It's this thing up here that would ring the bell to bring the workers in at the beginning of the day. As I was talking about the lamps, the change in the concept of time is huge here, okay? Because pre-industrially, people had an idea of time, right? You know when, like, noon was, but the idea of, like, being somewhere exactly at 1:30 every day or exactly at 9 a.m. every day, this was totally unheard of until industrialization, when these mill bells start ringing, and they'll ring at exactly 5 a.m. every day, okay? No matter what season it was, no matter what you were doing, and they would ring it every single day of the year. And so these pre-industrial ideas of time, of labor, of seasonality are all disappearing with these mill bells, and it's one of the prime points of contention of people really feeling like they're losing power over their own lives is the introduction of these bells. And so across the river from Slater Mill, you'll see this church in Pawtucket. If you're driving up 95, you'll actually be able to see this church. And it's kind of a testament to early worker resistance that we still have in Pawtucket. The reason is this clock face on the top, okay? So when millers would ring in these mill bells, they were the only ones with access to the concept of time, right? Workers didn't have watches or home clocks because no one used time in that capacity. So the mill owner has a monopoly on the very idea of time. Of course, they're going to exploit that. So commonly what would happen is the mill owner would bring in workers for their shift, but then lie to them, right? So you'd say your workers, tell them they'd worked 13 hours when in fact they worked 14 hours, right? It's time that still happens in jobs today. In more high-tech ways, but this is kind of low-tech ways. So in 1828, workers in Pawtucket collectively raised about $500, which is a lot of money at the time, and had this clock face installed on this church, which was the sort of highest point in town overlooking all these mills, so that workers could collectively have some, retain some power over the concept of time. So this isn't marked or anything, but it's well-documented history. It's not that the original one burned down, but there's still the restoration, which is still here. This is our spinning throttle. This makes the completed thread. This is kind of what these machines would look at in the time period. Also something that these children would be running on. I'm just going to kind of keep running through until we get to the strike, because that's the important thing. We don't have a ton of time. This is Slatersville, Rhode Island. This is the mill kind of falling apart, looking pretty decrepit there. It's since been restored. So these are the power looms. This is really the next big technological advance in the textile industry. The first ones come into play in 1814, but they're widely adopted, maybe the 1820s. And this means you can go from cotton to finished cloth all under one roof in one factory. So this really revolutionizes things. And when you look at textile mills today, largely in other countries, these looms don't look that much different, right? They're not going to be powered by water power anymore. But fundamentally, the idea of it is all the same. So this has a big economic consequence, but it also marks a big demographic shift in these mills because these are a bit too complex for really young kids to operate. So the next group of people we get in these mills are young women. So women aged maybe 15 to 30 become the main group of people who are working in these mills. Mill owners were able to pay these women significantly less than men, some half the wages of men from the very beginning. The kids working here at the beginning would have been boys and girls. Even there, the girls were paid slightly less than the boys, so there's that gender discrimination even from the beginning of the textile industry. But with all these women entering, the mill owners continue treating them like children, right, and still have these same kind of oppressive policies and mechanisms. But the women, of course, are much more prone to uniting and fighting back. And it is these women in 1824 that lead the first textile strike in U.S. history, which happened here in Rhode Island, in Pawtucket, and was led by these young women loom weavers who were working on machines just like this. And what happened was, in late May, so right around this time, all of the mill owners in Pawtucket as a class got together and decided to both cut the wages of specifically the women loom weavers in Pawtucket and to extend their work day by an hour. And in this notice that they give to the young women, they even say, like, the women's wages are already, you know, far too high for, like, young ladies or whatever language they use. When they hand out the notice, immediately about 102 women walk off the job. They called it a turnout back then. This kind of industrial strike had never happened before in this country, in the UK to some extent. But they go on strike, they meet. We don't sadly have any documents from these women, so everything we have written about this is from, like, the mill owners' newspapers or from the mill owners' documents themselves. But, you know, they organized, got about 102, elected a leader, and for about a week, the city of Pawtucket was in a sort of riot, right? They got a lot of the kids who were employed here, some of the men as well. They marched to the mill owners' houses, were throwing stuff and yelling at the mill owners' mansions in town. A mill was set on fire. I'll just read one of the newspaper notices from this week here. And it goes on for an entire week. So this is from the newspaper at the time. It says, when the laboring part of the community learned the result of the mill owners' meeting, they very generally determined to work only the usual hours, and when the bell rang to call them to their employment, they assembled in great numbers, accompanied by many who were not interested in the affair, around the doors of the mill, apparently for the purpose of hindering or preventing the entrance of the weavers assembled in Parliament, in the number of 102. One of the most active and talkative was placed in the chair. The result of the meeting was a resolution to abandon their looms unless allowed the old prices. And then this is from one of the mill owners' diaries from June 1st. It says, this morning was alarmed by the cry of fire, fire, fire about 4 o'clock, which proved to be the stone factory. Without a doubt, it was set on fire by some person or persons as they were found concealed in bales of cotton, large coals of fire. Last evening, nearly 200 mechanics assembled at the hotel. The result of the meeting, I do not know, but if for the result not to work more than 12 hours per day, nor less wages than they have had, public notice is given to all the respectable people who wish to pulverize and restore peace to our villages requested me at the hotel. And they do actually request assistance from the state of Rhode Island, who sent a police force. In fact, one of the first manifestations of police in the state of Rhode Island was to shut down these riots. At the end of the week, the mill owners were so scared of this unprecedented unified action that they actually paid and gave these young women, restored the wages, and I think they compromised on the hour, but it was largely successful, okay? So this is the first strike in U.S. history at the first textile mill in U.S. history, 10 minutes from here, and it's led by teenage women, right? We think early U.S. labor movement, you have these images of this, like, you know, man with a big muscle and a hammer or something, but from the beginning, just like these teacher strikes are now, back here, it's also led by these young women. This, of course, sets off strikes all throughout the region, in Sauket, in Blackstone, and continues, and we can keep on talking about this, but I think this is a good place to end things. This is just a painting by a woman named Christine Ashley for an exhibit we had at Slater Mill a couple years ago to commemorate this strike around this time. This is obviously not realistically what this strike would look like, right? It was at many, many mills throughout the city, but just to give some kind of I think that's all for my time. Thank you all for listening to me, and I think this gives us a really good informed history to now understand how the textile industry has moved to other locations to just simply repeat a lot of these atrocities, and gives us also some insight into what needs to happen on the the workers' end, I'm organizing to kind of take back that power to raise these working standards in these factories.
This is a lot of landfill.
present. I don't really feel like I need to educate you guys about where we're at, but the things that we're making and how we're making them, whether it's apparel or it's packaging or any other commodity item, I mean, the materials that we're choosing to put into them, they're not going away anytime, ever. Not soon, ever. They're never going away. Plastics is at the forefront of that problem. So there's a reason why you've been throwing away things for a long time, as humanity has been, but you know, the clay pots that you dig up from Mesoamerican times, it's not going to be like that in 1,000 years. I don't know what it's going to be like. It's going to be a big problem unless we start to figure out how to recapture it into a new stream. So one of the streams that we have looked at, or that I was looking at and brought to Sarah tonight, was this PET stream. It's one of the better known feedstocks, the PET bottles that we drink water from, that so many people drink so much water from, and then throw away after a single use, actually are recyclable. Unfortunately, most of them don't get recycled. I think the stat in the United States is pitiful, something like 20% of all of our recycling is recycled, and the PET bottles is even less than that. But more than 100 million plastic bottles are used worldwide every day. Enough plastic is thrown away each year to circle the Earth 4 times. It takes one PET bottle 700 years to start decomposing. And by the way, it never really decomposes. It just becomes smaller and smaller and smaller. An estimated 1,500 plastic bottles end up as waste in landfills or in the ocean every second. Only 1 out of 5 bottles is recycled, so 20%. The rest just becomes litter, gets buried somewhere. Plastic bottles are the fastest growing form of municipal solid waste in the United States. Each year, more than 4 billion pounds of PET plastic bottles end up in landfills or as roadside litter. And actually, that wasn't really such a problem until the end of 2017, because we would just take our landfill and kind of sort out some of the recycling, put it on a boat and ship it to China. Oh, but they just said no to that. And if you're not aware of it, you ought to look up some of the articles about it, because thankfully, people across the globe are freaking out. They don't know how they're going to handle all this garbage. So that is a little bit of background of some of what I was thinking about. But then, you know, I work at Samsonite. We have to make luggage. We've got to sell luggage. Got to innovate, got to make new forms of luggage, because people, believe it or not, always need more luggage. It's incredible. America doesn't sell a lot of it. But you know, taking a different approach from the materials aspect was my sort of passion pet project, and I wanted to set the stage a little differently and ask the bigger questions, like, what should we represent as a company given the state of affairs, like the picture of the landfill that I just showed you. You know, who's our customer really, who are we serving? And you know, we stand for quality, but what does quality really mean today? So I introduced an idea that maybe we ought to be connecting with people on a more emotional level through luggage. I mean, let's face it, we're all full of it. Why can't we do it? And you know, what does the shape of that connection look like? Maybe there's something a little more handmade feeling about it, like that Beaver's Isle porcelain works. Maybe it's a little nostalgic, like a little Beale, a little Italian Beale. Or maybe it's just something quiet, like LeBron shaver, that people just like and don't know why. Couple that with this idea that we're all here in some form or another to talk about this week, you know, fashion with a conscience. People are actually concerned about where the things come from, the transparency of the materials that are working their way into the products is becoming important. So, sorry. This slide is what I figured Samsonite could bring to these questions and to this approach. It could bring volume. Not this kind of volume, but big number volume to the question of the materials change. And I decided that we could really make a big issue out of the material choices. Choices could matter. And it's not so easy, actually, to change over materials, introduce new materials streams into a giant machine like Samsonite without poly. It's hard. So we chose a very large program that we do and decided to make that the test case for introducing PET recycled fabric. We went to the factory that converts 4 billion bottles annually. If I have this data here later, 4 billion bottles annually. It converts at the beginning of the mill from the bottles, and at the end, it's outputting POI and FDY yarns. They have a warehouse. It's about 2 football fields long, and they have a warehouse at one end. That's the warehouse where they collect and mail all of the bottles, and then you walk through the whole thing. I'm going to show you a video of what it looks like. At the other end is this yarn, this beautiful yarn that's getting shipped all over North China to be woven into fabrics. This is a picture of a couple of the workers. I mean, it's an incredible thing to me. They're converting 400 billion bottles at this plant. And it was this one guy, another woman, sitting under this, I can't even describe it. It's a baler, but it's just this giant piece of iron. He was hand wiring with the bale. You know, hand wiring those giant cube stacks of bottles. He's doing this himself and then using a compressor to compress it into the cubes. I mean, this is how things work. This is how things get made. You ask who's making my clothes, well, you know, it's people like this, right? I'm going to show you this video. Into polyester, not into packaging. As textile people, I think So again, synthetic PET melt, you know, it's either polyester or PET resin. 68% of that turns into polyester. And but the interesting thing, and this was enlightening for me, is that for every 1 ton of RPET that we're using, you get a 1.5 ton of CO2 carbon footprint saved. So there was an impulse for us to go forward. Because again, you know, working for a public company, a large company, you know, we can't just decide that we're going to do things without proving our case. So we did a little research too before going forward in development, and we figured out that, you know, the bottles per case that we would end up consuming, so 58, 43, 32, 24 for various sizes of luggage. We also looked at the Hague Index and the score for RPET versus virgin PET. It's very high for RPET. The grade ultimately of A versus a grade of D for virgin polyester. As a public company, one of the things that I'm really proud of is that since going forward with this project and getting the attention of the global CEO, we've made some very significant progress in the area of sustainability, and one of the key goals of the company is to be carbon neutral by 2030. So things like the Hague Index are going to come into play real heavily in our design process, because there's not, you can't just get to a carbon neutral by 2030 without making some very major changes, and it's not just going to be a product of the climate. Again, we did some graphic work because this was new. Samsonite had never touched any of this type of material. In fact, they're still terrified in some ways about it. So we have to really do a lot of educating about what the material even is. People are afraid of it. They ask questions like, is the luggage going to melt? Does it have a higher, you know, what's going to happen to it? Is it as good? So we have to remind them that it's just polyester. We didn't want to put the product on something that had, you know, the same old form factor, so we did a lot of work investigating not only that emotional connection through the fabrication, but also the kind of forms and benefits. The new product plus the materials would be something very new for the consumer. And this is one of the mock-ups that we came up with, the finished product. So it's in the market now, and I wanted to share some of the stats because they blow my mind, actually. We put out one collection, but that collection turned into four collections. The four collections turned into another collection. And when I say collection, I'm talking big numbers. Like we will consume, you know, 400,000 yards of fabric on a collection. It's big numbers. So the bottles that we've been able to divert to date, just on what we've shipped, is 13,204,201. If we add what we're about to ship, that's going to go up before the end of 2018 to 26,076,206. The yarn that we purchased to date is 364.57 megatons of yarn. The textile that we've woven, 911,425, so we'll hit a million pretty soon here. The pieces we've shipped, 347,574 pieces to date. That's going to more than double by the end of 2018 to 741,000 pieces of luggage. And our carbon offset is 525 megatons. And again, that's going to double before the end of 2018 and probably into 2019 to 1,050 megatons of carbon offset. And I'm still working through, you know, converting these into other metrics to help educate our shareholders, our public, and our internal, even our internal customers, you know, the salespeople, the marketing people, because it's sort of such a, it's new to them, really, like this idea that you can switch and that these numbers have meaning for the public at large. China is not immune to this idea, though. China is actually going forward with its new five-year plan, and it's got very aggressive goals for environmental cleanup. Very aggressive goals that are, you better believe it, affecting the manufacturers in the United States. change is inevitable, then it's a great time to take the reins and look for radical, real change that, in many cases, can be economically viable as well. I also wanted to share a couple of some other technologies that we're looking at that are either already out there, they're available. I've been to some of these mills in China already. They're all actually already available, so let me take you through these. So there's something, this is more for apparel, and maybe you guys know about this company, but Genealogia is a company from Spain. They've been around for a while, and what's great about it is that it's a sort of plug-and-play unit that allows you to really decrease the amount of water that you're using in your dispersed dyeing processes. They're using a nanobubble technology, and they're able to get to force the colorants into the fabrics, and they're able also to do different finishes, especially to jeans, to denims, with a significant savings of water. And again, me being in the manufacturing sphere, the reason I'm really attracted to this is because A, they say that it's technology that's useful for any textile, not just jeans, and then there's this plug-and-play aspect, so that you're not having to tell factory that they've got to completely overhaul their infrastructure, but no, they can buy this unit, plug it into their washing machines, and do something very new. Another very real solution, and something that I am trying for people to adopt more, is solution dyeing. And if you don't know what that is, it's sort of weaving the material and bringing it to a greased state. You put the colorant in at the point of extrusion through the spinnerets, and it can work for any synthetic. There's some limitations to it, but I brought you guys this VR spin dye company because I've been there in China, and they really are advanced in terms of the colors that they can offer. They have a beautiful physical museum room of color where it's schools of color in a 3D matrix, and they've got the formulas just so dialed down. They know how to create the same color across many different mediums, many different deniers. It's originally a Swedish company, but again, they've got a test house outside of Shanghai, and they've got a bigger one, I forget where it is, in China. But they're very well established. The materials are not expensive, but they're beautiful and they're very cool. I think you guys have heard of Parley. I hope you've heard of Parley. They're the guys that are working with, I forget the name of the outfit that's actually going out on the ocean. Parley's really more the marketing end of that. They're not really the guys out scooping up this stuff. But what's significant about Parley is that they've been able to parlay that work into consciousness. And this is a big thing, because going after sustainable practices in apparel, in fashion, in commodity products like luggage, accessories, it's not just turnkey. You cannot assume that your consumer is going to pay more for it, care. I mean, we all want to think that, but Parley is really doing a good job communicating why people should care. And as soon as they make the education out there available for people and do a good job of pushing it out there, people do respond, but they're not, the public at large is not necessarily clamoring for this information. So it's part of our jobs. It's like a new piece of work that you can't just make the product. You can't just try to take responsibility for changing the materials. We've got to also communicate what we're doing. I put collecting and sorting up there. It's not just relevant to Parley, but I mean this whole idea of where they're collecting the raw materials, being in the ocean, trying to collect all this micro garbage. Collecting and sorting is just in and of its own is an area of great interest for anybody that's interested in sustainability, in recycled content, in closing the gap on materials, closed loop economies, because the way that we deal with our garbage and the way that we deal with the downstream, the way doesn't exist. I mean, there's some ways, but it's very disorganized. There's not common practices. I just came from the EU from a conference China, like it or hate it or whatever, you know, it is the manufacturing hub of the planet, and it's set up with so many conversion manufacturing processes. I mean, from, you know, everything that you can really conceive of, what isn't coming from China anymore? India also, but it, they're involved in every process, and so they're like, they're perfect for being a transformer for all this waste, for all this downstream waste. And so the fact that they've shut off, they're saying, well, we have enough of our waste, thank you. It'll still go into those streams, but it's kind of scary that there's nowhere else in the globe really that's set up to be as efficient with that refinement process as China is. Plus Foam is another company. They're collecting post-consumer goods, and they're extracting the foams from those post-consumer goods and reconstituting them into many different materials. Foam-based, granted, but he's been in business long enough. Brett Ritter is his name. He's been in business long enough that he's even starting to get secondary materials out of his primary materials, which are really mechanical compression materials, but he's looking at that he's got this waste stream from that process, and he wants to make it into backings, and it starts to become this very interesting, what are we doing with all this petrochemical? It's going into first class use, and then second class use, and then recapture use, and then, you know, is that waste stream possible to become something else? It really is kind of a very fascinating, hopefully potentially closed loop system. TerraCycle is another company that's been around for a while, and you've probably seen that, you know, stuff from them where they take the potato chip bags, create it in the bags. But they are evolving, and the latest thing they did was with Target. They partnered with Target. Target ran a really promotion to bring in your baby car seats and put them in a box, and you'll get some kind of a coupon off of a new baby car seat, and then they shipped all those baby car seats to disassembly plants, and then the disassembly plants, you know, extracted the materials that they could for recycling, you know, upstream or downstream recycling. But the funny thing that we learned talking to them was, we were kind of like, honey, those car seats they're not worth anything. Like, the stuff that we can extract out of it, because I was like, well, how much did Target pay you to do that? It's in the millions of dollars. And I was like, well, but all the materials you got out of those car seats, right, that must have offset it. No, not at all. It was like, no, it was still millions of dollars, even with the extraction of those materials. And so there's this other burning question in my mind that's kind of, you know, related to the Plus Phone, you know, getting value out of these downstream wastes. You know, how are we as a society going to change the value that we have for what waste is? And so it leads to an even bigger question for me, which is, you know, why do we even have a construct of garbage? When does something go from being a comfortable thing shiny on the shelf to, oh, it's just a garbage that's now in the waste bin? I think it's really important that we struggle to understand what our psychology is about that, and why do we have that construct of waste. And I'll end with, you know, William McDonough, who's a fan of, and he runs the Rocky Mountain Institute, he has that book, Natural Capitalism. I'm sure some of you have read it. But I just love, you know, he talks about the cherry tree, and the cherry tree does produce waste, right? It produces waste all the time, especially in spring, and most of nature does do that. It just sheds, it litters all its petals on the ground, but they're beautiful. So maybe it's not about that there's a problem that we create waste as human beings, but maybe it's about the materiality of that waste. You know, what is it doing to the planet? How does it affect the biosphere that it occupies? And I think we could do a better job. I think we're going to have to do it quietly, because I think wringing our hands and ringing bells and trying to get lots of attention, whether it's legislative or whether it's through the retail environment, I don't know that it's going to work like that. I think we have to kind of sneak attack it and just make it so. Thank you.
you want to learn a little bit more about any of the individual items I talk about, and that'll be available. So I'd like to talk a little bit about the future of fashion. We've learned a lot about some of the things that I've done in the past, and Janelle gave us a really nice presentation of all the optimistic things that we could be doing in the present to offset some of the things that we know that are negative in the present. But I think that there's cause for optimism, quite honestly. There's so many exciting things happening. Right now is such an amazing time to be a young starting out designer, or even a middle of your career designer. Some of the things that are happening are truly astounding. So I'm going to sort of briefly launch into this. In some ways, it's more speculative than the two presentations that you've heard so far, because I'm kind of looking into the crystal ball. Some of these technologies do currently exist, and I'm sort of offering the question of, like, sort of how things benefit us. So the first thing I would like to talk about is one that I'm particularly excited about, and it's about biotech in the fashion industry and the textile industry. Like, what kinds of things of benefit for the fashion revolution movement can biosynthetics be doing, things like bacterial applications to improve our carbon footprint or to make things maybe more precious to people? I think a big theme that we've been hearing throughout Fashion Revolution Week, which is a bit of a change since its inception several years ago, is that in order to make real change, we're going to have to change the mindset of the consumer and to try to offset this throwaway mentality. So some of the things we're going to be talking about are how do we make what they're purchasing more precious so they don't want to throw it away whatsoever. So some of the interesting things that have come out, well, some of them are already available or they're just on the brink of being available commercially, are fibers that are new kinds of natural synthetics, rayon-like fibers with silk-like finishes. The spider silk, which I'm sure many of you have heard about through gold fabrics. Had made a really beautiful orange dress that you see hanging up here. She made this dress it's a one-of-a-kind piece at the moment, and it was made for the MoMA exhibit as Fashion Modern that happened last summer. Gold fabrics has been doing really interesting things. The spider silk isn't actually spider silk. It's made from a protein emulsion, but in order to get the fibers to react the way they wanted, I guess they did a lot of testing on actual spider silk. There's also fibers that are made from milk proteins. This particular dress is by a designer, Anne Damask, I think I'm pronouncing her name incorrectly. But it's also got this like really nice silky drape, and it's all made from proteins derived from milk products. And then the one in the far right-hand corner is an orange-based fiber. These ladies started this business inspired by the fact that they were seeing so much waste of the orange product. I guess in the region of Italy that they live in Sicily, they produce so much orange juice that they have all of these husks that were just left behind. And it doesn't seem like it's dangerous, a waste product, because eventually it would break down, but I guess it's cumbersome, and it's another raw material that could be, in fact, used. Again, they produce a nice silk-like fabric, and they've actually gotten a nice partnership with Ferragamo, so they're producing clothing using this orange fiber at Ferragamo. There's lots of interesting things happening with alternate leathers. There's lots of options that are vegan-based. The exception that I'm going to point out is that there's one that is actually made of jellyfish, which is a really interesting concept. segue away from that in doing some articles for the Polychrome blog on emotional applications for smart clothing. I had a chance to talk to a couple of people about the ethical implications of that. Like, if we have clothing that can sort of read how you're feeling at any given moment, is that okay? Is it okay if somebody kind of has their heart on their sleeve in a very real way? And if it's done with the best of intentions to, say, help a patient that might be struggling with some kind of mental illness, like, where does the line stop where it isn't okay and it's just invasive and intrusive? So I think as designers and creators, we actually have these questions to ponder too, just as scientists do to some degree. Like, at what point are we crossing an ethical line that we're not comfortable with? Maybe it's wearing a backpack. I think bacterial innovations have a lot of potential, and I think they're really exciting. So I don't know if you know this, but we have a lot of interesting things going on right in the Massachusetts area, just over the border, not very far. And although I know for a long time New York has been sort of like the pivotal scene in the fashion industry here in the US, being in New England and close to Boston is actually a really interesting place to be now that we're talking about using biology in conjunction with textiles. I think that we're going to find that having that proximity to MIT, even to various labs, maybe the Brown Lab, biology lab, could be something that could be really useful. So the items that you see to the far right are materials that have been dyed using bacteria, the one that's sort of like floating up there in the dress. Her name is Alice Fine, and she creates these garments with textiles. She dyes the textiles and garments with bacteria that she gets from decaying flowers. The piece that's sort of in a turquoise background, it looks like a little silk handkerchief. This is a bacterial dye that was created by an artist named Nancy Audrey Sheza. So I had the opportunity to meet Nancy at a party at Ginkgo Bioworks. Ginkgo Bioworks is a lab that is in Boston Seaport area in the design building. And Nancy was our very first artist in residence. Now, if you went on Ginkgo Bioworks website about 6 months ago, you'd have no idea that they were interested really in textiles. I mean, they have a biological lab there, and it's mostly geared on the website. I mean, it looks like it's geared towards agricultural applications and things of that nature. But they have the wisdom to consider bringing on board somebody who was schooled as a textile designer and as a fashion designer, just to see like what can she do. And I think that we're going to see a lot more of this cross-pollination between designers and scientists as people start to see more and more applications. So one other thing I want to mention before I stop talking about Nancy and Ginkgo Bioworks is that for all you students out there and young designers, Ginkgo Bioworks just announced that they are having an open call for new artists in residencies. It comes with a stipend. I think that they want I think they want the artist to come in sometime in 2018, but I think they're kind of flexible as to when that will be. And I think the application deadline for that is it's May 14th. So the hyperlink to that is in this doc. If you're interested, or you can just come and ask me about it, or you can go on Google Bioworks site. But I think that's a super exciting opportunity for a young designer. The image that's here in the lower left-hand corner is made by a company in affiliation with MIT, so it's the Biologic Lab, and they infuse textiles with bacteria so that it can specifically react to the wearer's moisture levels and heat, body heat levels. So this particular piece was made for dancers so that the vents would open up to ventilate when the dancer got too hot or was perspiring too much. So this might seem like it might not have crazy applications, but it really could do some amazing things in the field of athletics specifically, and dance certainly, but also in footwear. So Puma is also collaborating to create different packaging for their products. So this package here has bacteria infused in the packaging so that it will biodegrade much more rapidly. But they're also using bacterial technology with the MIT lab to create t-shirts that will react to the wearer to make them more comfortable. So there's lots of exciting sure that we're addressing what they want or to get them more excited. A lot of what makes someone buy in the first place is a very emotional response. I mean, any person that's taken marketing courses or sales courses will tell you most of the purchases that people make, even if it's something that they actually need, the actual decision to purchase said thing is an emotional one. And so I think that that kind of loops back to what I started the discussion with about how are we resonating in a way with customers so that the products that they're buying are so precious that they don't want to get rid of them. I know that some of you might have heard Steve Farron's lecture yesterday afternoon, and I think that that's probably one of the most important things that we could touch on, is like an emotional connection with our customers so that the product becomes precious again. They don't want to throw it away. Maybe they're willing to spend a little bit more on it. Because the whole fast fashion cycle, like, that's actually relatively new, and it's been such a destructive force. You know, the fact that most people think their clothes are old in a year is just insane to me. I mean, only two generations ago, my aunt was like turning collars on her brother's shirts to make the shirt last longer. I mean, now it costs so much to dry clean a shirt when you bought the shirt for $10 at TJ Maxx. Why would you do that? You're just going to throw it away and buy one? But that's so gross, isn't it? Especially when the shirt probably has a higher polyester content than cotton content. So maybe using AI and algorithms could be a way of anticipating a need or a desire, or making the process of purchasing so pleasurable that they're associating that experience. So at the retail level, there are already some interesting things happening, and they're kind of clunky at the moment, but I think there's a lot of potential there. Things like interactive screens, or smart dressing rooms are calling them, or mirrors that can actually project the garment onto the customer that's looking into the mirror without them having to try it on. Maybe they'll have it on their size, or you know, maybe it's a sort of thing where the customer wants to see it in the color of the flip of a switch. And you know, let's face it, some people are really kind of excited by all the gizmos and things that are out there, and having this experience to play could be another reason to get them into the stores. The stores are now struggling with how do we get customers to come out and see what it is that we're doing. In-store experiences also offer or may provide a way of further personalization and customization, and again that could tap into making the product that the customer truly treasures instead of one that, you know, just looks like the same $10 shirt that everybody in the world is wearing. It's something that's particular to them. So I think that one thing that's really happening in the world that's really interesting is that in some ways people are sharing more and more of themselves online, but at the same time we're really disconnected in a lot of transactions from people. And I think that at the retail level, that's one of the things that can cure that industry, which sort of seems like it's in a free fall. Like, you keep hearing how dead retail is, but I don't think that that's true. I don't know if I just sound like this crazy optimist, but I think stores need to have a mindset change too. I think instead of being a place that just has, you know, tons and tons of clothes that customers are just wading through, maybe they need to be more like ateliers and experiences. Kind of like Bonobos is doing something really similar to this right now, where you go in and an experienced salesperson greets you, treats you like a human being. They work with you, and they make sure that you get the right product for you, and they order, you know, whatever it is that you need. It could be somewhat customized or personalized, and then it gets delivered to you. That feels like a service that you might be worth paying a little bit more for. Very recently, I made a mistake when I was at the ATM. Of course, the bank is open. So it's a big, beautiful bank, one of the old ones. It's still lined with marble and everything. But no, I just chose not to have a human interaction like a lot of us do. And I went to the ATM, and I took out more than I intended. So I went back inside the real building and intending to deposit like the extra. And the bank teller was so happy I was there. It was kind of pathetic. Like, she was in this gorgeous building all by herself. Nobody else was there, which is kind of alarming, actually. There wasn't even a security guard. Because nobody's there anymore. That happened in one generation, that people aren't having these human interactions anymore. So even though what I'm showing you is a lot of screens, I'm thinking that maybe a combination of this with some really personalized service, because maybe the people that are actually working in the store have time now to focus on the customer, because it's not like a hot mess in the store with all this product they have to get back on the shelves. There's maybe one representation of that beautiful product, and then they can kind of help you through the process. So how can AI and algorithms help at the and like the design part and the production. So there are some companies out there, I'm sure you've heard of Stitch Fix, that is working with algorithms to create data-induced design. So I'm a little ambivalent about this. I don't think it's something that we shouldn't be acknowledging because it's there, and I think people think it's kind of exciting that, you know, maybe they can eliminate design results altogether and just let an algorithm create this perfect blouse for you. But again, I'm ridiculously optimistic because I just don't think that people are going to love this in the long run. Like, you know bad design when you see it, right? Sometimes you don't know why it's bad, but you know it's bad. Like, you look at it and it looks like garbage. Even a small child knows when something is bad. Small children will, like, look at two or three pairs of shoes and believe it or not, even though they often have gruesome taste, like, still they'll often gravitate towards a thing that are a little bit better designed. You know, sometimes it's because the functionality of it is better through the design. But often it really just boils down to aesthetics, like Janelle was talking about, like considering an emotional reaction to the design that they were making. They were looking back at vintage pieces to kind of grab at a nostalgic point. So I think that there's a place for designers in this, and I don't think that we have to be afraid of the algorithm. I think though that, how is it that we can leverage that? I don't have any answers on this actually. How is it that designers are leveraging all of this data that we could have available to us in order to deliver to the customer that experience or the emotional connection or that nostalgia that they want in the trends that we see going forward? And then there's some really interesting stuff happening at the promotional and the advertising level as far as AI and algorithms and that sort of thing are going. So there's these digital models on Instagram. And like their popularity is just crazy. It's pretty much off the hook. Like the one that's here in the upper left hand corner, I don't know if I can pronounce her name or if it is supposed to be her name. I think it's Lynn Phillip. She's got over 100,000 followers. No, actually she's got 1 million followers. This, you know, completely made up sketch. I mean, she's beautiful. She went to Coachella recently. So I think that's really fascinating that they're creating these illustrations and they're putting these clothes on them. You know, they're getting contracts from, you know, high brands, high fashion brands to like display this product on a model that isn't really there, and that's sort of fascinating too. I don't think the modeling industry is going to go away from it, just like I don't think the design industry is going to go away just because maybe a machine could design a blouse that will look great. Then there's also the concept of using polygrams, and this is like a very artistic piece. This was a piece that was taken off when I did a search for like hologram goggles. So this is like someone's interpretation of what the future might look like. I wonder if at some point this would become such a common thing that then the goggles themselves become an accessory that people want to have. So part of the point of going to the fashion show is even like showing off your goggles. Or maybe you don't go to the show at all and you're able to experience it from home. So I think all of these things are going to make shifts in our industry. The item that's in the lower right hand is the concept of using 3D modeling not only for applications for consumers but possibly even for designers. So maybe these are ways that, you know, we can present work internally or we can present work to private label clients and so on and so forth in ways that they can see and they can understand. And these figures can actually walk around and take a turn and do all these things. They still are a bit crude and they still look kind of robotic and look as fluid as human beings, but it's interesting. Something that would have looked like witchcraft, like, you know, 20 years ago. So there are advances being made all the time. And so then the last segment I wanted to talk about are manufacturing advances. So how can tech further more sustainable models? We saw some really miraculous things in the slideshow that Janelle presented and the factory film that she showed us. The thing that I found the most remarkable when I had seen that film the first time was how devoid it was of people. Like, there really weren't that many people, and she said it was 4 football fields long. So the fact that they could keep this completely sustainable business up and running 24 hours a day and churn out that much product and really not have that many people, it's a far cry from the factories that we saw in the earlier part of the presentation. So we come to the part about low-waste manufacturing. And two of the things that I'd like to talk about would be the 3D printed garments and 3D knitting.
they're doing and what's going on there. It's really nice to be able to go in the studio and take a quick peek at what they're doing. So 3D printing has lots of marvelous applications, especially for footwear. We've already started to see a product out there in the athletics field. I'm kind of curious to see how it's going to take hold in other kinds of footwear. Right now, it seems like sneakers are really working. Companies aren't spending all of the money innovating, but I see no reason why it wouldn't just sort of spread onto other kinds of footwear. Another closed demo resource that you can go and check out is Ministry of Supply. Maybe you've seen them on Newbury Street. They have this wonderful Shima machine that can like knit an entire jacket. It still just needs like the buttons sewn on and a little bit of linking, but all of the ways from one blazer fits in this tiny cup. It's kind of amazing. And really unheard of. It's very cool. You know, like you can go in and you can get fitted for a custom one, and they also have ones that are pre-made. And I think your blazer is finished in like a week, you know. It's kind of amazing. And then the last thing I think is what most people think of when they think about advances in manufacturing, robotics and automation. So we saw it in action in the film that Chanel brought, but there's advances being made in this all the time. And this is currently happening, not just in creating new fibers, but in actually creating products. There's a company called Sobo. They have these sewing robots. I don't think that robots are coming to get people's jobs anytime soon, but I do think that maybe they could take on some of the more treacherous tasks, laborious tasks. Maybe they could make jobs a little easier for people. Right now, there are lots of limitations with the sewing robots, so there's only certain kinds of materials that they're able to handle because you can see that the t-shirt that's being made and the slide on the other slide, it looks like it's very stiff. That particular technology requires the material to have a stiffener added to it so that it can be cut out and it can be sewn, because they're using similar technology to when they're using cutting fine metal and sheets of plastic. So they can't sew things that can't get wet at the moment. So it's really relegated to the categories of t-shirts and sewn knits, things like that. But I think that, you know, more innovations like that are definitely bound to be coming along anytime soon. Other innovations that have slowly been adopted, and you know, we want to see a lot more, we're taking away the most dirty and like dangerous of jobs that are being still done, you know, by hand for the most part. The whiskering of jeans. Have you ever seen any footage of how it traditionally gets done? Like, there's just a human being who sits there with like sandpaper, chemicals, and it's terrible. You know, and they're releasing all of this dust. So the newer technology just whiskers the jeans in a matter of seconds with a laser. I mean, it's very clean, and it's just not in this horrible environment where someone's breathing in the dust or exposing their skin to all of these chemicals or breathing the stuff in. I've heard of a lot of interesting innovation with jeans as far as like using very little water, getting acid washing techniques by just like tumbling it with certain stones and things like that instead of having to like actually throw chemicals at it. So I think that there's lots of innovations right around the corner that are making these things sustainable. It's kind of a matter of how are we getting them to get adopted more wholeheartedly at the manufacturers. And so this is the part where the designers are going to have to sort of make the demand where you just say, no, we're not going to place it at that factory. We want to place it at this factory. We don't want to do that there to save however much money we would. We want to do it here. Maybe we'll cut costs someplace else. Closed loop dyeing, which we already talked about a little bit, using no water, no chemical processes, or if there is water, then it's being kind of recycled and repurposed, and it's not just being like released back into the river with all this dye stuff. And the last thing is smart clothing. So honestly, I don't know if this was definitely the best slide to put smart clothing on. It probably could have like a whole presentation unto itself because it's a really interesting category. But I think that it speaks to making the item more precious for consumers. So I saw it here under innovation. So Levi's has this commuter jacket that's now already available to be used. And there's been lots of interesting advancements with getting circuitry into